people know to comment as well.
Broadcast is live.
Cool. Yeah, we're live. Wish I had
my Louisville Slugger in the shot too. You see that right there?
Oh, is that for people who try to come?
It's for if the union comes in. I'm ready. You know. Watch it. I'm like, someone's gonna say now it's like I'm violence. I'm threatening violence. Nah,
no,
it's
you're not.
Baseball bat. Yeah. Anyway, it's fun to hold though. It's fun to it makes me feel powerful.
While we're showing toys, I showed my new microphone.
Oh, nice.
The last podcast too, but I don't know. I think I figured out how to set it up. It's just I don't have the whatever it's supposed to plug into. So that'll have to wait until next week.
Oh, I see.
But something
it's an analog mic. It's an analog. Is it an analog mic?
I mean, all this stuff plugs in. You know, this stuff plugs into something.
Yeah.
So I don't have whatever it plugs into at the moment.
Exactly.
Yeah, and it may look like Bob and I are just chatting. Don't worry about it. You know, we know we're live. Just to let everybody know.
Yeah.
But we're just, you know, waiting for people to hop on. It looks like we already have a good amount of people on. But I just want to take this time also to remind everyone that this is streaming from 5 different platforms. If you want to check it out, take your pick. We got the choicemedia.tv YouTube, the choicemedia.tv Twitter account, my personal Twitter account, my YouTube account, and also my Facebook account. Looks like we have a lot of people viewing from Facebook and Twitter right now. So thanks for hopping on. I also want to let everybody know that, you know, we can talk to each other all day for hours and hours. And if you want us to listen
to your
thoughts,
of course, even when the cameras are off.
Yeah. I mean, we were talking for an hour before this as well. So, but don't worry, we haven't lost steam yet. We were talking a little bit before this about a lot of the stuff that's going on. And we're really excited to share with you today a lot of what's going on as well with the Harvard stuff. People already know, but also we can feature your comments. The point is we can feature your comments on from any of these platforms. So be sure to stay engaged just to show you what that looks like. It'll pop up at the bottom of the screen right here. If I click on it and we can respond directly to your questions and comments or even just feature them while we're talking. So don't be shy. That's where your comments will pop up. But without further ado, I think
let me do a clean in.
Yeah,
okay.
I think you, Bob, you should take it away and we should get going. We have a lot of really interesting stuff to talk about today.
All right, welcome everybody to Random Assignment. My name is Bob Bowden with Choice Media, joined by the great Corey DeAngelis from Reason Foundation. Corey, thanks for tuning in, everybody else. We appreciate it. And so, as Corey explained a second ago, you can tweet out with the hashtag random assignment, and the chances are we'll be able to find it and show it on the screen, and we will go. We had actually, even though it's a coronavirus shutdown week, you know, that we're in the middle of right now, boy, some big things have been happening, particularly with Corey and the subject of homeschooling. My goodness gracious, what an S storm. I think I can say that. That's probably
horrible.
Our crowd. Corey, tell us what happened. Something about Harvard University and homeschooling.
Yes. So a couple of things have been going on for the past couple of weeks, but just a few days ago, actually last Friday, Harvard Magazine came out with an article, and I'll bring it up in just a second, on the risks of homeschooling. And this was written by
Erin O'Connor.
She doesn't actually attend Harvard. She's not a professor at Harvard. But this whole thing was a highlight on the work of Elizabeth Bartlett,
yes,
who is actually a professor at Harvard Law School. And so she's highlighting the supposed risks of homeschooling. I'm trying to find this screen.
Go ahead.
The big issue here is this is a huge anti-homeschooling rant filled with propaganda based in not any statistics given in the article, but it's essentially using the exception to prove the rule here. And just to give you a couple of quotes from the article that are just absolutely, after we get to the quotes, we'll get to that image in a second because it's pretty ridiculous. But it highlights Elizabeth Bartlett's work, and she says that homeschooling not only violates children's right to a meaningful education and the right to be protected from potential child abuse, but it may keep them from contributing positively to a democratic society. And this just flies in the face of all the evidence on homeschooling, showing that homeschool kids, by and large, actually get way more meaningful educations than kids in government-run schools. And there's just no statistics in this article about how many kids are actually getting abused at home and whether forcing them to go to a government school actually leads to less abuse. I mean, if you look at the most recent Department of Education report on this, I will say it's from 2004, so it's from a long time ago, but this is the most recent statistics that I've seen on this, that they estimated that 1 in 10 students who attend government-run schools in the United States will experience some form of sexual abuse, not from other students, but from the school employees themselves. By the time those kids graduate from high school, 1 in 10, about 10% of students, they estimated for the U.S. Department of Education, that kids will experience some type of sexual misconduct from the employees. And so if we take Elizabeth's own logic, her logic is that, look, there is some abuse going on with homeschoolers, so we should have a presumptive ban on homeschooling. She calls for a presumptive ban, which essentially just means that she thinks that the burden of proof should be on parents to prove to the government why parents should be able to educate their own children in their own household. That's completely backwards. But using that same logic, she should, if anything, be calling for a presumptive ban on compelling kids to go to government-run schools. Because look, using the same logic, we see that a lot of kids are abused in government schools, either from their peers or from employees. So why doesn't she apply that same logic to the traditional school system? What do you think, Bob?
If I can do my own paraphrase of Professor Bartlett, it's basically this. Because it's possible a homeschooling parent might abuse their kid, we should just make it extremely hard to homeschool, make these parents jump through hoops to make the bureaucrats satisfied that these homeschool parents are good enough. Otherwise, we're going to just send them to the public school. Because it's possible that abuse could happen in that sector, we'll just default to send them to this other sector, basically. Let me just say a couple of things quickly. Since you brought up the regular public schools, you know, in 2018, the Chicago Tribune did their own study of Chicago public schools and how much sexual abuse. They did a 10-year study from 2008 to 2017. They went through 10 years of data. And what they found is that 523 reports of children sexually assaulted or abused. This isn't, by the way, children to children. This is all from staff or adults to the kids. And it's only inside the city public schools during the 10 years. So it's not like at home, anything else, or away in a car or so. A teacher did this to a kid somewhere else on a field trip. This is inside the public schools, adults working for the system, sexually abusing kids in Chicago. This is the Tribune's report. Over 500 reports of this. And one other thing, by the way, I didn't even plan on this, but Corey, can you pull up, we make a website called sexualabuseinschools.org. Can you just pull that up right now, Corey, and people can see it? And I hope it comes up. Sexualabuseinschools.org. So a lot of people, just start scrolling. A lot of people are absolutely dumbfounded when they see the sheer volume of these stories that appear all the time. We have all the original links. Choice Media publishes this. Any one of them, you could click on it. Wow. Go ahead, click on one just to show.
Did you see that one when the, I think a school employee forced a female student with autism to touch I think he was placed on administrative leave, right? He wasn't even fired right away. I don't even know if he's fired now.
Hundreds and hundreds of these stories, and people can't believe just the sheer volume of them. You know, if you compare it to the Catholic Church sexual abuse scandals from, you know, mostly peaking like years ago. You heard more about it, you know, 10 years ago or so. This is wider, broader, more. It's actually stunning. So anyway, so all of this, like, yes, we have a woman saying, oh, because it's possible, just the theoretical possibility of abuse and homeschooling makes them basically not only write this article calling for enormous regulation of homeschooling, but Corey, you also know about a conference they plan on holding.
Yes, and before we hit on that, I'm going to hit on that.
Okay,
in a second.
The graphic.
Check out this freaking graphic, man. It was. I don't know the name of the person who actually wrote it. It doesn't really matter. But the point of this is that it's accompanying this anti-homeschooling propaganda hit piece, and it's essentially showing, look, there's this poor, you know, sad homeschool girl that's locked away in her home
all
day.
She's imprisoned. Yeah.
And, you know, look, the books, the house is made of four books. One of them is actually the Bible. And I'm not a religious person myself, but the article goes into it and says, oh, look, a lot of these homeschoolers are conservative Christians, as if that's like an evil thing.
Yeah.
And then they jab at the religion aspect as well with building the house using a Bible, which just it's just a complete appeal to anti-religious bigotry. And I'm not a religious person myself, but I absolutely respect and understand that everyone else in this country, as American citizens, have a First Amendment right to the free exercise of religion, even if some Ivy League elites at Harvard don't like that fact. We have that right to freely pursue our religion, but it gets worse in this image. And a lot of people pointed this out originally, and I'll bring up the original image.
Oh, good.
If you check this out, and sorry, if I move over here, you can still see me, but look, the book Arithmetic is spelled arithmatic.
Yeah.
They replaced the E in arithmetic with an A, and a lot of people commented on this and bashed Harvard and said, look, you're trying to bash the homeschoolers on being miseducated, and you can't even spell arithmetic right.
Well, no. In fact, some people, you're trying to pretend like the homeschoolers can't spell arithmetic properly.
And that was a plausible theory, right? And I was like, oh, yeah, maybe they're right. But still, I mean, wouldn't you misspell reading and writing, too, if you were really trying to make that play? And, you know, maybe you could have botched it some other way.
Right.
But look, I think 2 days ago, it might have actually been yesterday, a few days after they released the story, they didn't note this, but they corrected this. Here's the new corrected version. Everything is exactly the same, but they outed themselves.
Yeah, they proved that it wasn't an intentional misspelling to make a point. By correcting it, they actually just the Harvard Magazine graphics people proved they didn't even know how to spell as they were in the midst of criticizing other people for poor education in homeschooling.
Exactly. So that's an extremely embarrassing self-own. If I was them, I would have played it cool and said, yeah, you know what? Those people are right. We were just taking a jab at the homeschoolers, but they made a pretty big mistake in my view by correcting it because they admitted defeat in that sense.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, this is, this highlights the work of Professor Elizabeth Barthollet, who thinks there should be a presumptive ban on homeschooling because, you know, there are maybe a couple of cases of abuse.
Talks about academics being solved. Sometimes they don't learn what they should learn, as if she forgets that 20% of American kids don't even finish high school who go to regular public school. The high school graduation rate leaves 1 in 5 without a high school diploma, who go to traditional public school. And this is lost on the fact is there's no biased presentation. There's no balance in the article at all.
That and they also magically and conveniently leave out the fact that 2/3 of 4th and 8th graders in the United States are not proficient in reading using the nation's report card. So 2/3, that doesn't a 33% proficiency rate doesn't seem very successful to me, but looking into Elizabeth Barthollet's longer work, she has an article in Social Science Research Network. I share some of my articles in there as well. So if you want to check it out, if you just look up Elizabeth Barthollet homeschooling SSRN, you'll find an article that makes claims like this, many homeschooling parents are simply not capable of educating their children. After all, parents didn't go to Harvard like I did, and didn't.
Right.
You know, they're not professors at Harvard. So how dare them try to educate their own children? They're just not capable of doing so. And I mean, there are some. There are some families who are that are not structured, you know, in the right way, and perhaps they don't have the best interest truly of their children. But that's few and far between. Right. She's essentially trying to regulate homeschooling for everybody just because of a few bad actors, and then also at the same time not applying the same logic to the government school system.
Yeah, hyper-scrutiny to one team and zero scrutiny to the other. And then, but then as you also found, Corey, you know, we could say, oh, this one crazy lady has these crazy ideas and hates homeschooling. There are more people that think this. And you found, I guess, a Mr. Dwyer, right? Let's talk about him.
Yeah, so Mr. Dwyer, and before we get into Mr. Dwyer, there's a whole homeschooling, anti-homeschooling propaganda conference
right. That's
being co-sponsored or actually hosted at the site of Harvard Law School in June 18th and 19th. And just so the readers can see, this is the focus from their own website. It says the focus will be, and if people can't read this, I'll blow it up a little bit right here. The focus will be on problems of educational deprivation and child maltreatment that too often occur under the guise of homeschooling.
Yeah.
So it's using the sensationalistic approach here. Even in the event description, you don't even have to guess what this event is about.
Yeah.
It is explicitly an anti-homeschooling conference, and it was co-organized by Elizabeth Bartlett herself. The other organizer is James Dwyer, which you alluded to. He has said some pretty ridiculous things, and I'll play a video just so that you can hear some of James Dwyer's pretty radical views that have been going pretty viral on Twitter and other forms of social media as well. Here's a clip.
It is not a good situation that regulation has largely disappeared from homeschooling.
Jim Dwyer is a law professor at the College of William and Mary. His forthcoming book, The History and Philosophy of Homeschooling, details reasons why he believes stricter regulations on homeschoolers is necessary.
The state needs to be the ultimate guarantor of a child's well-being. There's just no alternative to that. The reason parent-child relationships exist is because the state confers legal parenthood on people through its paternity and maternity laws. It's the state that is empowering parents to do anything with children, to take them home, to have custody, and to make any kind of decisions about that.
That's totally antithetical to American history and American historical thinking. In fact, the logical conclusion of an academic or a legislative policymaker who believes that parents are given rights by the state is that they can control everything.
So there it is. I mean, they concluded with Brian Ray. We talked about him on our last show, I believe, that Brian Ray's done a lot of good work on homeschooling and synthesizing the evidence, but that's the money quote right there. The reason parent-child relationships exist is because the state confers legal parenthood. You're only a parent because the state allows you to take...
It's a dumbfounding quote. As if before the state existed, there were no parents and children, right? It's insane. It's an insane idea. What sort of conceptual framework does it require to come up with that? Just quickly, you would think, maybe it's quaint of me to think of universities at a place where people could debate ideas, where let's throw it all on the table. Let's have the best minds coalesce and convene. And maybe they're radical ideas or maybe they're crazy ideas, but we will have all sides represented in some sort of, intellectual discourse, right?
And you would think so.
That you would think that would be a description of universities generally, but Harvard is arguing, some people would say, the best university in all of America, of all the places where you'd want all of the ideas on the table, right? You would think Harvard University, I mean, they wouldn't want to just micromanage groupthink to predetermine the outcome of a simple, narrow set of ideas, only these ideas are allowed in our conference. That sounds like censorship or somehow that's, and yet, go ahead.
And I mean, you don't even have to take our word for it. I mean, look at the preliminary conference agenda. If you just look, they have riveting topics such as concerns about homeschooling. And look, you know, someone's going to go into this big charade about
child maltreatment
as if that all homeschooling families are evil and that they just want to homeschool their kids for malicious reasons. Right. And then, you know, of course, they're going to talk about how, you know, public schools are necessary for a democracy as if public schools are the only things that can produce well-educated citizens.
As if there wasn't democracy before public schools existed.
That as well. But then also there's the most important one to me is the reform proposals panel. They only have two reform proposals moderated by James Dwyer, the guy we just heard from, saying that essentially your children essentially belong to the government and that, you know, you're only a parent because the government allows you to be a parent.
Right.
But look, there are two reform proposals are either an outright ban on homeschooling, a presumptive ban on homeschooling, or we should just regulate it off the planet, essentially defeating the purpose of homeschooling altogether by making homeschool families essentially follow the government curriculum and essentially turn homeschools into government schools, which that doesn't seem like a lot of good reform proposals. But if you look through the rest of this agenda, you won't see anyone who is on the side of educational freedom and who actually supports homeschooling. And so it's a completely one-sided conference, but it gets worse than that. It's not just the agenda. I mean, it's one thing to just show one side. That's bad enough. But it gets even worse when you look at the fact that it's an invite-only event, and it's private. I wasn't invited to the event. Bob, I'm sure as heck you weren't invited to the event. Carrie McDonald, the leading expert, in my opinion, in the United States on homeschooling and unschooling. Carrie McDonald, who went to Harvard University. I believe she got her master's from Harvard University. She wasn't invited to the event. Jason Bedrick from EdChoice, he got his master's from Harvard. He hasn't received an invitation to the event. So no one that I know that for any of my colleagues who are on the side of freedom in education, they can't even participate in the event. So
let alone present, right? Let alone present anything. We're not even allowed to show up at all because, why would they want an idea that differs from what they've decided is already true?
Oh, because we have the better ideas. That's why they don't want to let us in. And you know, if they invite me, I'll come and discuss this. And if you're watching and you're from Harvard, send me an invitation. I'll be more than happy to make the way out to Boston. You know, if we're not still under lockdown by June. But this goes back to the Harvard Magazine article, and you know, Ted Cruz tweeted about this. You know, he was super, super upset. He called this article barbaric and unconstitutional, myopic. This is partially why this blew up so much, is because Ted Cruz put a lot of spotlight on this. But if you go back to the article itself, people were really lashing out. You know, there was huge public backlash just because of the radical ideas that were presented here. And the comments section, it was blowing up. Harvard Magazine has probably never gotten this many comments on any article that they've ever posted. And all of these that, from what I can tell, are negative, getting tons of upvotes on negative responses to this article. What did they do? They completely shut off comments for the article. So just like the conference where they don't invite opposing views, they couldn't even handle allowing the public to respond to their article that's clearly anti-homeschooling. Hopefully they'll run some articles from our side. I think Carrie McDonald submitted a letter to the editor, so maybe they'll run the other side, and that'll be interesting to look out for.
But it's this whole kerfuffle regarding a Harvard article and an upcoming Harvard conference, it is part of a kind of a larger trend. And so, Corey, you and I talked about a commentary 4 years ago that Melissa Harris Perry of MSNBC had given on camera. She was fired not long after that. Now, the MSNBC didn't say that's why she was fired. So we can all make up our own speculation as to what part or percentage that played in it. But do you have the video of Melissa?
Yeah, I have that video. I'll play it in just a second. And just for the listeners, this was from, 2016 or something? I found the video from a 2016 YouTube clip. But it's eerily essentially an echo of what James Dwyer said. And it kind of assumes that the parent belongs to the state and not their parents and not themselves. And they belong to the government, essentially. But take a listen for yourself. Here's the full clip.
We have never invested as much in public education as we should have, because we've always had kind of a private notion of children. Your kid is yours and totally your responsibility. We haven't had a very collective notion of these are our children. So part of it is we have to break through our kind of private idea that kids belong to their parents or kids belong to their families and recognize that kids belong to whole communities. Once it's everybody's responsibility and not just the households, then we start making better investments.
Yeah, better investments. That's it. What is she going to go in, like, semiconductor stocks? What better? The better investment than the traditional public schools? Is that the? I don't know.
Well, I mean, look, on the point of investment, she says we've never invested in public schools in the past. I mean, that's.
We can make better investments. Yeah.
Check out the data on that. I mean, Andrew Coulson posted this. I mean, if you look, it's been updated. We now spend $15,424 per pupil in the United States. That's over $200,000. I think $200,512 in the U.S. for a K-12 education. We spend a ton of money. That's you can essentially afford a house almost for that much in the an average house price in the United States. You obviously afford a condo in some places for that price. That's a lot of money. And if you look at the trend over time, we have invested in education. Look at this graph. It's a huge percentage-wise investment. I think since the 1960s, we've increased per pupil spending by about 230% from the most recent data that we have available. So, I mean, that's just one issue. That's her whole argument is based on something that's not true. But then even bigger issue is that she says that we have to break through this private notion that kids belong to their parents or even their families and recognize that kids belong to whole communities. It echoes the same sentiment of James Dwyer that
it does.
They're not your kids.
Because there might be some abuse somewhere that we might find an anecdote on occasion of a homeschool family where a child is abused. Let's apply hyper scrutiny to that. Zero scrutiny to the public school sector, and based on that, say, we better just end this thing with the one anecdote, which is the homeschooling. We found an anecdote there. We better get rid of it or hyper-regulate it. I mean, that's what it is. And writ larger, too, I think that there is a certain philosophy. I just wanted to bring up, Corey, that it's kind of a philosophy of social engineering that says that, if we hyper-regulate something, there's a chance we can improve some outcome. So, let's say someone says we're going to ban fast food, make it illegal in the United States, because we have these elite nutritionists who determine through their careful studies that if we order everyone in America to eat this diet that we'll prepare for you and send to your house, there'll be less obesity, or there'll be less cardiovascular disease. And yes, maybe we can imagine a world that it's possible if you force people to eat this food instead of what they want, maybe you could have less obesity and you could have less cardiovascular disease. And you could say, okay, well, then that's a good policy. We should just order that. In other words, we can remove freedom. Freedom comes with the possibility some people will make bad decisions, right? I think you would agree with that. Obviously.
The government couldn't even get the food pyramid right. They don't know any better than us about what we were supposed to eat.
I know. But this is the theoretical argument, is that we can at least, if we force people to do this one thing, who cares that many people who have freedom will not like it or even not do better, but we can statistically reduce some bad outcome by removing all freedom. And that is an argument to say, oh, well, maybe there's some bad homeschool parents. So if we just force everyone in this other system, we can, it's an idea to say, It's a myth in elitism as being some sort of savior for our culture, that if we just have enough, and to which you referred a bit earlier, but if we just have elites having more and more control over what we do, they're really smart. And a lot of these dumb people won't do these dumb things.
Well, and I mean, it's punishing 100% of parents for the actions of maybe 0.1%. I don't know the statistics, but it's punishing everybody for the actions of a few bad actors. And then it's also not all clear that, you know, the government's policies actually lead to their intended outcomes.
Well,
I mean, prohibition, people were still drinking alcohol. It just made it a lot more difficult and costly. But it also made it a lot more dangerous, you know, with a lot of the people trying to ship these things illegally. When you put things into the black market, it makes it a lot more dangerous and could lead to a lot of other problems. So it's not even clear that if the government said you have to shop here, that people aren't going to, you know, still figure out a way to find junk food anyway, right?
No, it's not clear. It's just, this is the thin philosophical premise on which they hang these crazy ideas. Mm-hmm. Don't you see, if we just take everybody's guns away, then some one madman who shoots mm-hmm. people won't shoot people because we will have taken all the guns from everyone. So that way, don't you see that it's a way to say, if you remove as much freedom as possible, we'll have some bad decisions that won't happen. And so, but I think all of us know how that logic falls down pretty quickly. Like, well, how many people want to live a life with no freedom?
Well, yeah, and let's continue that logic. We have CPS today and they take away kids from parents for a few bad actors, you know, and that's cool. You know, there is a place for government to intervene when there are legitimate bad actors going on and abusing or neglecting their children. I am not arguing against that. But if you apply the same logic here to that, that would be that, well, whenever you have a kid, you need to directly, everybody needs to give their kids straight to the government because, hey, you might be abusive to this child. There is, you know,
we could run large government orphanages. All kids could be cared for by large government orphanages who could have a standardized level of care, right? That way, a particular kid wouldn't be, you know, malnourished or something because we find an anecdote somewhere.
Well, and check out this other quote directly from Elizabeth Bartlett that was quoted in the Harvard Magazine article. And this is actually beyond parody to me. She says that parents are essentially the authoritarians here, that parents are essentially have authoritarian control over their children. And she goes on and has the audacity to say, it's always dangerous to put powerful people in charge of the powerless and to give the powerful ones total authority.
Yeah.
I actually kind of agree with that second statement, but the parents aren't the authoritarians here. It's almost beyond parody that she doesn't realize that the true definition of authoritarianism is when you use government force to take away parents' rights to educate their own children at home just because there might be a few bad actors. That's the true authoritarianism. Taking care of your own kids isn't authoritarianism. And so this is just a statement that, to me, strikes me as completely lacking any bit of self-awareness on her part. And it's just beyond parody is all I can say about it at this point. And then also just above there, I guess if people are reading this, they play on anti-religious bigotry. They appeal to anti-religious sentiments here by saying that, you know, people, you know, parents might be religious. And I think they also cite in the article that some percentage of parents, that many parents who homeschool their kids are conservatives and they're Christians, as if that's a bad thing.
You're getting pretty good with this screen, Corey. I'm liking it. You're getting slicker with this thing. It's crazy, please. We're giving them too much publicity, but what do you say to somebody like that? You know, I mean, one thing, even just, I think as we said before, just even have her present at the conference, but allow other people to also make
it's
other-
because these views are completely inconsistent. They just don't hold up to even basic scrutiny. And that's why we had people essentially ratioing their article by commenting on it, and the public backlash was huge for a good reason. It's because no one in their right minds outside of the academic bubble actually thinks that this is a good idea, or actually believes the notion that your kids belong to the government and not to actual and shouldn't be taken care of by the people who actually do have a better incentive to actually care about their kids, and who actually do have the best interest for the most part of their children.
Don't you want to get all 500 parents whose children were sexually abused at Chicago public schools to give their thoughts on her view that authoritarianism is the parent? See, that's the danger. Dangerous is her word, like the dangerous situation. Let's get the 500 Chicago parents whose kids were sexually abused in Chicago public schools to comment on, you know, that the danger is authoritarian parenting. You know, get their thoughts on that.
I mean, all it is making the perfect the enemy of the good. I mean, we've said that a couple times now, but this is the same tactic that's used in the school choice debate. If you look at Diane Ravitch's most recent Education Week article, I think she cited some statistics. Even though she doesn't care about standardized test scores, that she doesn't think standardized testing is important, she said in that same article where she railed against standardized testing, she said, well, there are some charter schools that are at the bottom of the rankings on standardized tests in their state. And she leaves out the fact that this could be because they're serving disadvantaged families. But she also doesn't compare that to the failure rate of traditional public schools or government-run schools.
Of course.
So it's, again, making perfect the enemy of the good, and just not, I mean, just it's just mind-boggling that they're going to cite that statistic when the other side can just as easily say, well, I can find a failing government-run school very easy. So, I mean, you saying that there's a charter school that's not doing very well isn't very meaningful, especially since families can vote with their feet away from charter schools that aren't doing well. Of course, there are going to be charter schools and private schools that aren't doing well. But the point is that the parents should have that decision to take their education dollars to the best school possible. With the government-run school system, when your school's failing, too bad. You're out of luck. You still have to continue sending your child there regardless of your satisfaction level and regardless of whether they're actually teaching your kid to read and write and do math.
All right, you ready to move on?
Yeah, let's keep going.
Okay. So buckle your seatbelts, folks. I wanted to talk a little about Drag Queen Story Hour. Now, this
is... What is that?
I laugh, but I mean, it's okay. So I'd heard a little about this before. I'd heard this phrase, but there is a website. Any of you can go visit it right now if you want, called dragqueenstoryhour.org. And that is one shot of the homepage. And we're looking at, I guess, a child talking to a drag queen there. Okay, we don't know where that is. Who knows where that is. But then there's another photo of the homepage. Maybe we can pull up too. Mm-hmm. Also featuring what is obviously a school. And I started to become interested. There, this is on their website. It's on right on their homepage, actually, the second photo. And I started to become interested in this question, not because I'm a social conservative like Corey. I'm not a
libertarian.
Yeah, I'm libertarian too. And look, in the 90s, I was a Howard Stern fan. You might describe me as kind of libertine. I'm pretty, you know, please, if I try to present myself now as a social conservative, I would be the biggest hypocrite. That said, the idea of exposing children in public schools to some of this content is not just concerning to me, even to me and my kind of, you know, non-conservative values. But I think it's some of it, I think, is abuse. But let's go through it a little bit. We have, first of all, there is proof. It's not just the one photo we showed of the public school. There's actually proof that in a school in Brooklyn, we have a tweet that had been sent out showing this. Look, it's a quote, and we don't mean to be, you know, well, the name is right on the tweet. This is from dragqueenstoryhour.org. This is a teacher in public school in Brooklyn, Alexis Hernandez, thanking this group for presenting the story hour to her first graders. And the other one, I don't know if you have the other image, but it says that she's a first grade teacher and they're planning another story hour for next year. So this is happening in public schools. Mm-hmm. And so that's clear. And then some of the footage we found is pretty shocking. And so I want to show this footage and then, you know, and then we'll talk about it.
I need to know, could you be the one to call? when I lose control.
I'm not going to lie, I like the music.
Okay. Well, this was presented, this is a TikTok, as you saw there, so it's a public video. And in my opinion, now there, we don't know that was a school, I want to say that. Who knows what that location was. What we did see in the other tweet, though, was it's clear that some of the drag queen story hours do happen at public schools. Are all parents being asked if they are signing permission slips for this? I can't say either way, but I want to say this. What I just saw in that video, in my opinion, is child abuse. I think you have a little girl there and watching a presentation that is, to me, obviously a sexualized presentation to a little girl. And you have, I guess, parents that think that's fine in that room, in that video. And again, we don't know that was a public school, but I think this is, I mean, this is really concerning to me when you know these events are happening in public schools. And even if a sexualized, well, I consider that last clip shockingly sexualized for a little child. Again, if you're an adult, do whatever you want. We're talking about children here. And it's also clear that there are parents that probably believe that it doesn't even need to be sexualized, that they may not want their child exposed to drag queen story hour at all. And I would respect those parents' right to keep their children from being exposed to that if that's their point of view. To me, this is beyond the pale. This is a form of indoctrination and social engineering that I think is in a public school where it's you have to be there, and under the penalty of truancy laws, you're forced to send your kid in that place. I mean, I think it's a big problem. Corey?
Yeah, I'll say that I have a little bit more mixed views on the whole situation, that I tend to be on the side of the libertarians that, you know, let people be exposed to different viewpoints, even if you don't agree with the viewpoints yourselves. I think the main issue that I have, though, this is actually the only issue I have with this drag queen story hour, is that there are a lot of families who I may not even disagree with that vehemently disagree with this kind of activity going on in a public school. So my argument is that the family shouldn't have to pay for this kind of material. They should be paying for just basic math and reading. And then also, you know, this is something that the Cato Institute tracks at their battle map. Whenever families get into deep culture, you know, arguments about things that they deeply disagree about, one of them could be political things going on in the classroom. I tweeted about a teacher linking on their whiteboard, linking conservative values like the Second Amendment to fascism and actually genocide. And I can see how parents can not agree with some of those things, and it might really irritate them, and they may not want to send their kids to that type of material. They may think that that's indoctrinating their children in some way, especially if you're only, you know, presenting one viewpoint. So these are all of these things are related: drag queen story hour, political indoctrination in the classroom, and the school choice is the only way to actually, you know, make these things all work. Well, then families who don't want their kids exposed to this could just say, okay, well, I'm going to go to this private school over here, or I'm going to homeschool. The money should follow the child, and I shouldn't be forced to pay for the, you know, those kind of activities if I don't agree with those things. And I think that's the big issue,
right?
That we can disagree about all these things, right?
I know, but just at the risk of repetition, and I agree with all that. Of course, the school choice part is good. I don't think I think it goes far beyond just paying for this. I think we're talking about I suspect there are parents who don't know that their 6-year-old was getting this indoctrination, had no idea, I suspect, had no idea was happening in a public school, and that they, if they knew this was happening, they would go ballistic, and that it's, I also happen to feel it's morally wrong. I happen to feel, for a child, I feel it is, that is, you're sexualizing situations. And I know some might argue, oh, that example of the sort of lap dance kind of thing or whatever, maybe that wasn't at a public school. Maybe what happens at the public school is more just reading a book with, you know, a guy in a dress kind of thing, drag queen. And that's calmer and there isn't dance music playing. Okay, whatever. But my view is that it's, I think you're going a little easy on him, but
I like to play both
as
sides.
As is obvious.
I like to play both sides, you know. But yeah. I mean, honestly, I think the main takeaway for me is that people should be able to vote with their feet. And yeah, it's not just paying for it. They if they truly believe that, you know,
it's
something
sneaking
bad is
in indoctrination under their noses. That's different than just paying for something they don't like.
Yeah.
We all might pay for a you know, military aircraft carrier that we're not for the aircraft carrier because we think we have too much. Like, we pay for things we don't like all the time in government. This is different.
And it seems to be left-leaning policies that tend to blow up with, you know, whether it's, you know, drag queen story hour, or if it's, you know, the teachers linking conservative values to fascism and genocide. I see that a lot, but I've also seen it from the other side too, where a teacher said a lot of pro-Trump things and essentially an economics professor, I think it was, or a teacher, it wasn't at the college level, at the K-12 level, was teaching that Trump's economic policies with trade were just super great, but, you know, he didn't really, didn't seem like he was teaching both sides of the lesson. So I can see how it can be both sides, conservatives and liberals.
I'm fine with that. Yeah, I'm fine with that.
And, you know, the main takeaway is, if you think your kids are being indoctrinated, you shouldn't have to send them there, and you obviously shouldn't have to pay for it.
Right. Okay. All right. What's next? Next on the hit parade.
I mean, there's a lot of things we can talk about. We can talk about how some schools are essentially giving away all A's, or at least considering giving away all A's, you know, throughout the rest of the school year. I know San Francisco Unified School District actually is considering it. I'm not sure if they came to a conclusion yet, but they were strongly considering, and this was a move that was strongly supported by the union, from what I could tell on social media, that we're just going to give everybody an A. And, you know, a lot of people were calling this a participation trophy for academics, but I think it's even worse than that, because you don't, from what I could tell, the policy would be that you would get an A on the assignment, even if you did not turn the assignment in. So what I like to say is, this seems like a participation trophy for everyone, regardless of whether you participate or not. It's just a trophy.
I mean, why would they say, it'd be one thing to just say, we're not going to give grades this semester. That I could, if, you know, maybe if a superintendent said that, or a State Department of Education commissioner said that, I would be more sympathetic, you know, to say that we should tell them they get an A. I mean, I can't imagine why that would be the decision. And imagine college admissions. I mean, forget about middle school for a second, but for high school kids, and the seniors, I guess, are probably, of course, not all seniors go to college, but for those who are, you know, those who are going to college, they're probably usually admitted in the fall, I think. But what about, you know, freshmen and sophomores and juniors in high school who are getting grades that will then be sent to colleges? Imagine some of them all get automatic A's. Other ones get automatic passes. Other ones get no F's allowed, but D's through A's are allowed. Like, they have this myth, all these districts are coming up with completely different policies. In other words, if you're a college admission person, I would think it would be pretty confusing to figure out.
It's almost like it's a tacit admission that grades aren't all that important, that grades are essentially meaningless, and they just show that you can jump through a bunch of hoops and listen to your teacher.
Yeah. I don't know if you saw my trolling tweet, Corey, this week. I tweeted out, hey, you know, something like, hey, look, San Francisco School District has decided to start evaluating its students the same way it evaluates its teachers.
Ooh.
Meaning give them all an A.
Yeah, let me find it really quick.
Yeah, a lot of parity between the all A for the students and the thing. Where have I heard that before? Huh?
And the big issue here, I think, is, I mean, they're selling it as a way to reward students for, you know, having to go through the crisis, and they're trying to, you know, go easy on students. But I think, you know, students are the ones losing here because they're not having to get an education. They're not having to complete any of the assignments, essentially, is what is being proposed. But then also the teachers aren't really being held accountable if this is the case. If the kids don't have to turn in their assignments, they don't have to grade anything. They don't have to teach anything in theory.
We talked about that last week with the Los Angeles Union negotiated so that no teacher ever had to do any online class or instruction at all, you know, if they didn't want to. You know, they had to just say they worked 4 hours a day, I guess, but no classes are held. Let me ask you, let's see, there was another thing I was going to get to. Oh yeah, the charter school story. Do we have time to bring that up?
Yeah, I can pull it up. We have plenty of time. I'm here all night. I'm here all week.
So this is a top story in Choice Media right now, and in our smartphone app, by the way, which actually I'm told that I shouldn't say smartphone anymore. That's I'm dating myself or something. I look like dorky.
I call it smartphones. What else would it be? Really? Just regular phone?
Mobile. They would say mobile.
Mobile device.
Yeah, mobile device. Anyway, So this it turns out that U.S. News put out, and I guess this is the National Alliance's coverage of the U.S. News story, but they put out a listing of the nation's top high schools, and oh, surprise, surprise, the schools, the public schools of choice, meaning charter schools, were far overrepresented in these lists of top schools than were traditional public schools, and I'm guessing maybe even magnets. I don't know, but it says here. Although charter schools make up slightly more than 10% of U.S. high schools, they're 18% of schools in the top 5%. And they're nearly a quarter of the schools in the top 1%.
Wow.
So I guess if you have to draw parents, you have to get families to come to you to get to stay to exist, maybe that kind of creates an existential incentive that is not happening in schools of coercion, as I like to say.
Yeah, that makes total sense. If you have to attract your customers and retain your customers, well, you'll probably do a better job. And I will say that, I mean, I don't know what these rankings are based on. It's probably based on like AP testing and, you know, just based on results, you know, standardized testing results, AP testing results. Hopefully it has some form of satisfaction in here as well. But I will say that when you start looking at the evidence on non-test score outcomes and non-academic outcomes, charter schools do a better job too.
Yeah.
Because parents know, or parents, you know, aren't going to voluntarily send their kids to schools that, you know, aren't safe or aren't, you know, leading to better democratic outcomes or civic outcomes or, you know, making your kid a more tolerant citizen. So, I mean, the evidence is also highly positive for other outcomes too. And it doesn't surprise me that charter schools are punching above their weight.
Mm-hmm. A couple housekeeping things just to insert before, so I don't forget. But this program is now an audio podcast as well. And we're now on Stitcher, which is a popular podcasting app, as well as Google Podcasts, as well as, I think, almost attunein.com. Attunein is an app for podcasting. The one holdout might be Apple. I'm not sure we're there yet, but we will be soon, I'm quite sure. So anyway, so if you don't have time to like watch it on the video version or whatever, you can tell your phone via Stitcher or TuneIn or Google Podcasts or whatever, and soon Apple to sign up for our random assignment. I wanted to point that out. And Corey, I also want to ask you too, like, what is your, I've been also debating with friends just separately offline about kind of the coronavirus thing. What do you think about it? So I have like coronavirus, I have friends, you know, across the spectrum, like most of us, I have like coronavirus skeptics who are like, oh, we've way overblown this response by shutting down the economy and the misery and suffering because of poverty will far outweigh the virus. And then I have other friends who are like, holy, we should be shutting down way more. This is a terrible threat. You know, it's all we can do to keep from, you know, massive numbers of deaths from this virus. Where do you stand on it? What do you think?
Yeah, I have mixed feelings about it, obviously. And the risk, I think the risk is for people, if you downplay it and you were wrong, that is a bigger risk than,
But at some point,
if you downplay it and you're wrong, that's a bigger risk than blowing it out of proportion, at least looking back. Just personally, okay, if I come out here and say this is a big waste of time, and then it turns out that I'm wrong in 10 years, then that'll look really bad on me. That's a bigger risk for me individually. So I think a lot of people just say, oh, it's bigger than it actually is.
Well, just to be devil's advocate, though, I would say, what if we find, what is it, half of America living paycheck to paycheck?
Yep.
You know, what if there's soon riots at supermarkets because people don't have jobs and they don't have money and they can't eat? And, you know, you shut down the entire economy. You could be like, okay, yeah, three weeks. At some point, this is more than just, you know, the one story of the virus issue.
Yeah, I saw someone on social media say something along the lines of one of their friends or something lost their job and committed suicide. So, I mean, there's so much of this unseen that people are not taking into consideration. And as Henry Hazlitt said in his book, The Economics in One Lesson, or maybe it was someone else, but the difference between a good economist and a bad economist is that the good, it might have been Bastiat, the good economist takes into account all effects of a policy prescription, not just the visible effects. Might have been Bastiat, but Hazlitt drew a lot of his ideas from Bastiat, from my understanding. But essentially, what people are doing is they're looking at the COVID-19 deaths and cases, but they're not looking at what the policy prescription, the effects of the policy prescription of closing down the economy has on people. And one of those results is it could be an increase in suicide. And then
drug abuse. Domestic violence.
People could become addicted to alcohol because they have nothing else to do. So I think we need to weigh both sides of the equation. And for far too long, we've just been looking at one side of the equation. And any reasonable person should be able to look at this from both sides of the story.
And there are real
world negative impacts happening from closing down businesses. And it particularly has negative effects on people who don't have savings built up. So the least advantaged, in theory at least, could be being harmed most by the shutdown.
Which is another issue with elitism and looking at our own prism of how we see the world. And maybe I am better off than this other person. So I think, of course, we should all,
I'm working from home. I'm fine.
I work from home too, right. Fine by me. But I have friends who actually are laid off right now. I have friends who are making no money at all, just living on savings and hoping for the best. And we have this actually an experiment happening in real time. You know, Sweden basically kind of didn't shut down. They're doing some things where they're saying if you're highly at risk, then maybe you stay home. But they're kind of just, let's see what happens. And there was a CNBC story today that I saw that talked about how some are thinking that Sweden is near a kind of herd immunity level where it actually they might get through it and not have a big problem. Other people seem to think that their problems are only beginning and they really screwed up. But Sweden is going to be this experiment in real time of what if you kind of do nothing. But the
problem is, I mean, it's only a sample size of one, right? So like I think someone on my timeline has said something along the lines of Sweden actually has a higher death rate than some other countries,
but we don't know in the world seventh.
Yeah, so we don't know the counterfactual there because perhaps Sweden has a higher death rate than a country nearby that closed down. But we don't know what the death rate in Sweden would have been if it didn't close down.
Right.
We don't know if it would
Norway.
Be any lower at all.
Right.
There are so many differences between Finland and Sweden, for example,
sure.
that this is just an issue. I mean, if it's going to take a lot of data and looking back from economists in the future to look back at the best that we're going to be able to do, I think, is look at differences in timing of shutdowns and see and try to plug that into models to see to provide a better counterfactual than just looking at one country and comparing it to one other country. So
and
I'm interested to see what it looks like. We may find out that, that maybe the policy response was too big of a response for the relative risk of the pandemic. I don't know. But we're going to need to see a lot of data on this going forward. I'm really interested to see what the data look like.
Right. And I'll, one last thing I'll add on this is that there's a study that came out about 4 days ago from Stanford. And this study's the methodology has been also attacked. So it's been questioned, too. But what they said, what they found was that somewhere between 49 out of every 50 to 84 out of every 85 people exposed to the virus won't get sick. They're suggesting that there is already a widespread antibody, widespread immunity in the population. And so if you can imagine a situation like the fatality rates we've been looking at so far have taken the people that are sick and looked at how many die. But what hasn't been done is to say, well, gee, what if a lot of people might be exposed to the virus and never get sick? So what if if you only start with the people who get sick, you're ignoring all these other people who are kind of immune, and that's an enormous part of the picture here. And excluding them, this is a study again has been attacked. We'll see soon. I'm sure they'll probably repeat it and see what happens again. But this could be a thing where many more of us are immune than we know.
Cool. Okay. We're running up right at about the hour.
Yeah.
I think we've hit all of our topics, and you know, this hour flew by super quickly.
It was good.
There's just so much to talk about this week, especially again with Harvard's atrocious attack on homeschooling. Again, in the Harvard Magazine piece with highlighting Elizabeth Barthollet's work, professor over at Harvard Law School, but then also a June conference that's coming up that's hosted at the Harvard Law School. June 18th and 19th, they're not allowing, or they're, from what I can tell, there are the homeschool views of homeschool supporters will not be represented at that conference. And this is really blown up in the face, I think, of Harvard Law School. And, you know, I think for good reason that these are some pretty radical views. And essentially, let's play that video clip again from James Dwyer, just so everybody gets a little bit of a reminder of what we're kind of talking about and what we're dealing with.
It is not a good situation that regulation has largely disappeared from homeschooling.
Jim Dwyer is a law professor at the College of William and Mary. His forthcoming book, The History and Philosophy of Homeschooling, details reasons why he believes stricter regulations on homeschoolers is necessary.
The state needs to be the ultimate guarantor of a child's well-being. There's just no alternative to that. The reason parent-child relationships exist is because the state confers legal parenthood on people through its paternity and maternity laws. It's the state that is empowering parents to do anything with children, to take them home, to have custody, and to make any kind of decisions about that.
That's totally antithetical to American history and American historical thinking. In fact, the logical conclusion of an academic or a legislative policymaker who believes that parents are given rights by the state is that they can control everything.
All right. Hey, I just want to say quickly, everyone, if you like this brand new little program we've got here, please share it and like it on social media. Please help us out. You know, if you think it's the worst, awful, most ridiculous thing you've ever seen,
share it anyway.
Actually, I heard somebody say once, then hit dislike twice. That's what you do. If you like it, hit like once. Anyway, so thanks, Corey.
Yeah, thanks for joining us this week, and join us again next week at the same time, 5 p.m. Eastern. And we'll talk with you next week about whatever's going on in education media. Again, this is our show, Random Assignment, with Bob Bowden and myself, Corey DeAngelis. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you for watching, and thank you everyone for commenting.